You're listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network, now the largest new media platform on the web, and your number one source for after-show entertainment.
The AfterBuzz Studios in Los Angeles, California. Presented by Maria Menounos and streaming live thanks to Akamai Technologies.
This is AfterBuzz TV's Helix After Show.
We'll break down tonight's episode and get you all the latest news and gossip. And now, another post-game wrap-up show for your favorite TV show.
It's AfterBuzz TV's Helix After Show.
Helix fans.
Welcome back.
Yeah, welcome back. Oh, yeah. Let's get that hotness. It gets me every time.
I have so much space this week.
I know. Am I especially low today, or is that just my headphones? Who knows? All right, well, welcome everybody to the Helix After Show here on AfterBuzz TV, another great installment, Season 1, Episode 9, Level X. I am Matt Lieberman. Joining me on the panel, of course, Mr. Zach Wilson.
Hey, guys.
Steve and Lemieux on the ones and twos.
Hey, guys.
Unfortunately, Liz Rusmaui, she's feeling a little under the weather today. She's not going to be able to join us. But send her some love and well wishes out there on the Twitter. She's at Lizzie Maui, LizzyMawy, on Twitter. Let her know that you miss her. We'll be happy to have her back next week. So another fantastic episode. I would love to say it's two game changers in a row. Can I say that? Because like last week, you know, we have the standoff with Constance dealt with. And now, for the first time, we're kind of seeing the whole team working together. Like, you know, the tension is still very much there, but we're learning more about the Silver Eyes. We're learning more about Arctic Biosystems. We're getting, you know, more of Hiroshi Hitaki. We got some reveals this week. How'd you feel?
It was nice. We got like, we opened up, everybody kind of woke up on the right side of the bed.
Yeah.
They're all positive people now, except for the whole death creatures down below
right.
thing.
No one going wants on. Death creatures.
But yeah, I mean, I agree. We got the escape at the very end, and we got Peter as the vector who would be king.
Yeah, he's like the god king of these vectors. They, you know, they take him, they revive him, they take him out of the suit, and then they all basically zizz in a cup and then make him drink it. Ooh. And it fills him with like this angry power energy.
Fills him with vigor.
He rises and starts screaming as only a vector can. And now he's basically their de facto leader. We'd been talking about hive mind mentality weeks earlier, and now we're seeing it come to pass as they're all kind of behaving, swarming as one. And he's somehow the conduit for all of their combined consciousness.
Can I just say how disgusting that scene was?
Oh, where they're all spitting?
Yeah, it just reminded me of like chewing tobacco and people spitting into a cup and then somebody pouring that into somebody's... That imagery is just not...
It doesn't sit well in the stomach?
It doesn't sit well with me. No, it doesn't.
I feel bad for poor Neil. That must have been quite a day.
You know, I don't think they...
really fed him that.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, for Neil, it was probably, hey, we're going to pour chocolate syrup from this cup.
Was that not
mouth.
One shot? I thought that was all in one shot.
No.
Okay.
It cut to him on the ground after everyone's
I'd say it wasn't that bad. But
because
still.
He doesn't need to be getting his ziz infested with...
More ziz. I don't know. Maybe it's like it's like a cocktail. Like you combine it all, it becomes a super ziz.
Well, I do. I mean, you have to ask what does it
accomplish?
Mean? Like, yeah, because we haven't heard Peter scream like that. He's been the only one of the vectors who's been intelligent to this point.
Right.
As more than likely because of the he has both NARVIK A and NARVIK B. But. Now he's more closely down with them, except for that moment where he jumps up and he like yells to the crowd.
Yeah. Here's what I think the real question is what is ziz? What is it?
Ziz is it's the device to transfer the virus. So what that kind of means in a way is ziz is NARVIK A, or NARVIK B.
NARVIK B.
Yeah.
So what? More than likely, more than anything, you know, the Sodra had largely killed the virus in his system. They put him into hypothermic stasis just so that the virus wouldn't continue to replicate and take over his body again. So I imagine that the combined ziz of everyone, you know, just helped it take over his body again, and it just brought him back to life, brought his adrenaline levels up to spiking. You know, we wonder why he's this conduit, and I have to imagine it has something to do with having both NARVIK A and NARVIK B in his system. That's the only difference I can think of, unless there's something genetic.
It's like he half transformed, is what it is.
Yeah.
So he's like, he's more on their side because now he's introduced to more of the NARVIK B, or NARVIK A. Which one is it that makes
NARVIK B? NARVIK A is just the straight virus.
Yeah. So he's introduced to more of NARVIK B. So now he's kind of going full vector in a way, except he's still got the intelligence left from that NARVIK A let him keep.
Interesting. I mean, we saw some very primal intelligence from him this week. He didn't speak, and I'm wondering if he's still capable of it. I'm sure we'll find out in the weeks to come. Four episodes left in the season.
It reminded me of the blue monkeys from Evolution when they jumped up out of the thing.
You quote Evolution all the time, and I need to just see it already.
Great. Googa Mooga.
Yeah, I need to see Evolution. That's my fault.
Speaking of Evolution, I want to go over this theory that I had during it. By the way, guys, if you have not listened to the interview with Mark and Ime, because you only usually go on YouTube to watch the episode recaps themselves, you need to go on YouTube and that iTunes and listen or watch and or to the interview we did with Mark and Ime.
Yeah.
Because it's pretty awesome. And we come up with theories halfway through, and I want to expand on one real quick.
Please do.
I love this theory.
So if in case you didn't hear that podcast, this is my theory, is that the master race is these gods. And, you know, they like to use history and they like to use all these things a lot. And especially with this episode, with all of the strains of vaccines throughout the centuries.
Yeah.
Guys, they are the master race. Like,
I mean, they seem to be immortal.
They seem to be the ancestor race of humans. And the virus itself that they want a cure for is humanity. So they want it to be a way to cure the planet of this plague of humans.
Oh, wow, because we're wiping out all of the planet's resources and polluting it. If they were able to tip the scales in the other way, perhaps planet Earth could be repaired before it's too late. That's what you're saying.
In some ways, yes, and in some ways, no. Because I don't know if they can no longer multiply, because every time they multiply, it comes out as humans, and that's like... What this really reminded me of was the story of the Greek gods. And if you look at the Greek god stories in a literal sense, as if Hatake or a being like Hatake is Zeus, and then you look at their first children and you look at their children's children and how the genes disperse throughout time.
Right, and they get further muddied as they continue to mate with humans and be in contact with humans, and we're dealing with demigods versus gods. You're saying that that Julia is, in effect, a demigod.
That's what I'm saying. In effect, Julia is a demigod, and a lot of Greek mythology also has to do with the eyes.
Hmm.
And even like Medusa, Hercules, everything had like the very piercing eyes. So I really think that they're going to steer this in a way that these people have affected history throughout, as in they're the deities of history. Like if you look at Greek gods, like they have just been perceived in that way.
Hmm. Now, here's my question. Mark, in our interview, I believe, said that we will have some idea of what these things are by the end of the season, or am I misremembering?
He hinted that we'll get a little bit more information.
We'll get a little bit more.
I think it'll be one of those things that they give us an answer that opens up a million more questions. I love the idea that these are an ancient race, and the Greek gods thing is just, I'm a huge Greek myth nerd. But I think this could end up going back as far as, because I was thinking about Steven's theory as I was watching this episode, and we have like the vectors and the silvers as these two very, very separate things. And I'm starting to wonder if maybe whatever the vectors are, because they're not, it's not just a pure zombie, like the way that we sort of gotten used to it.
Not a zombie.
I wonder if this was like an ancient sort of like battle of some kind, like these two races existed years ago.
To answer that question, you have to take into account Hatake's motives and what he said in that scene in his office when he finally kind of explains to Alan and the gang what NARVIK B was supposed to be and what these silver eyes were up to. that they wanted a virus that would wipe out the human population. Mm-hmm. He refused to do it, and what he was doing, he considered to be a kindness.
Yeah, I imagine that's what the Willis hypothesis is referring to, is the idea that if you take out this percentage of the population, the planet will rebound.
Okay, but but Ilaria doesn't seem to be on board with the Willis hypothesis.
I think the Willis hypothesis, we're going to find out that the Willis hypothesis is that the humans can be turned into the master race. Like the virus that bonds on a DNA level, which is turning what... Okay, do you guys play Mass Effect?
Yeah.
Okay, you know what the genophage is with the... what's that species called?
I've never played Mass Effect,
It's been a while, and I only played the first one. Can you explain it in broader terms?
Okay, the genophage is one alien race infected another alien race in which the women of that race cannot give birth anymore.
Got it.
So if you take that in a way of, imagine this master race was infected with something that made it so they can only give birth to lesser beings.
Or... If they turned humanity into something that was controllable, that wouldn't wipe out the planet, but instead would thin out the population, but not kill everyone through like this silent killer of this airborne virus. Do you know what I mean? Where there will still be whole communities of humans that will be able to remain alive, potentially large communities, if we can stem off the spread of Narvik B, but if these things are afraid of the Silver Eyes, they can be controlled and potentially be used to rebuild the planet.
Interesting.
While keeping the humans in check and basically killing less of them.
I mean, we have to wonder, what is it that makes them afraid of the Silvers?
Yeah.
Like, if we have to assume that there was something that they did in the past.
It could be that, because... I'm only agreeing with you on that because of the hive mind, which may have existed before these vectors were created. Mm-hmm. But I think what's more likely, because they can see, you know, heat in humans. That's what they were able to see at the top of this episode with Sarah running through the hallway and the vector mm-hmm. chasing her. And we had last week. They can see heat in humans. They can't see it in Silvers. And I have to imagine, you know, you see something that's moving around, but in your mind isn't necessarily alive. That's got to be terrifying. Or they're genetically predisposed to fear them.
Okay, I also want to say one thing too, is that they see heat in humans, and then what do they say? They said they're drawn by heat. Mm-hmm. So, and then you see in the culture where it explodes. This is a virus who's infecting the mind with the sole goal of becoming more, like spreading itself.
Yeah.
That's why they track down things with heat so they can infect things with heat. That's why they go towards heat. That's why they see with heat vision, because the virus wants them to see things that are warm so it detects it as
so
living
life. So
that it
can infect them, yeah.
But at the same time, you don't know why they can't see the Silvers, but I think it's kind of, if it's a hive mind, it's a dominance thing, because there's a difference between when Julia meets the Vector and when Hitaki meets the Vector. Because when Hitaki meets the Vector, it's completely a dominance thing. He stands next to it and he basically orders it to salute.
Right. It's docile.
Yeah. So the Vectors have they know who's dominant. So it kind of makes me feel like the disease, if they spread it to the whole world, everyone would be subservient to them as they once were.
Right. Versus just wiping them out entirely. It also, unlike zombism, they don't die. They can still be cured. Like, that's something that makes it a bit different from Narvik A, is that, you know, Narvik A, they were going to wipe out, say, 90% of the human population and then give the cure to the remaining 10%. With Narvik B, everyone is still alive, even though they're infected and they're controllable, which means that everyone eventually could be saved, which is what I think was Hitaki's play here. If everyone, you know, is still alive but unable to further damage the planet, we can use this race to rebuild the planet and then revive everyone without wasting a single life.
That's an interesting theory. And it makes sense that Hitaki, because he's got his own little, like, I can save the day with...
complex.
Yeah, I got to stop... his I don't know if they're his, I guess they're his superiors. So not that, so if we're going with the Greek myth,
he's not comparison, Zeus.
He's not Zeus. If anything, he's maybe Apollo.
He's like Apollo or maybe like Hephaestus, maybe, if we're using.
Hephaestus would be a good comparison. Yeah.
But I love all this speculating and this discussion.
Can I speculate a little bit more?
Just a little bit more, and then I got to bring it into what happened in this episode.
Okay, let me find my thought again real quick. So looking at another standpoint too is, you know how they're freezing the vectors to hold off the infection?
Yeah.
If you imagine the evolution of the human race is an infection in itself, then the virus is just a way to stave that off.
It's a counter virus.
To counter the evolution of the human race as they go further and further from the master race, while the master race can devise a cure to bring them back to being the master race.
Definitely.
So the Willis hypothesis is that you can bring a human back to the level that it was before as the master race. Like bring a human back to Silver Eye status.
But
they are trying, but they don't believe that's possible, which is why they're trying to just stave it off as long as possible.
How did humans get created? Did they create humanity?
But my only thing with that is that is Sutton's reaction to Julia's existence. She called her, she was basically offended that Julia existed. She calls her an abomination.
Yeah.
And if they were trying to make humans into the next level of like of the Silvers, well, the Master Race.
I think that's what he's saying is that no one at Ilaria likes the Willis hypothesis. No one at Ilaria wants to raise humans up to this level again, but this hypothesis exists that it is possible. I think that's what you're saying, right, Steven?
Yeah.
Okay, gotcha.
All right, I love this, but we gotta talk iTunes and then we gotta break down the episode. We don't have a ton of time today. Folks, don't skip. You might have already. If you did, I'm a little upset. But I'm not mad at you.
You're not hearing this anyway.
Yeah, you're not hearing this anyway. But for those of you who stayed, you're my favorites, and that's why I love you. So here's the thing, folks. AfterBuzz TV, you know the drill. 70 hours a week, original content, all free, streaming, downloading, websites, technology. We live in the future. Incredible. Buzzwords. Here's the thing. For all of that effort that we put towards putting out a spectacular product, getting you cast interviews, it was crazy this week watching the show and realizing, well, it's like, we talked to him, we talked to her, we talked to him. You know, we've talked to so many people on the show. We're going to be talking to Miguin Fairbrother in the next 2 weeks, which is really exciting. That's in the works.
Plays Daniel, if you don't know.
Yeah, he plays Daniel / Mixa.
His name is Mixa.
Yeah, Mixa. Mixa. And Taluk. We'll talk about them in a bit. But, you know, we put a lot of effort into putting a stellar product out there for you. And what could you do in return? Doesn't cost any money. Go to iTunes. Go to iTunes. Slap us with a rating. Give us a review. It takes a second, and it legitimately means everything.
You can do it right from your phone.
You can do it right from your phone. It means a lot. I'm just going to read two shout-outs. Not sure if we did them on Wednesday, but I don't care. Tan Linner says, prediction, 5 stars. See, he's just giving us a prediction, and he's still giving us a 5-star rating. Love this team's style and this podcast. On the Sci-Fi Channel, they have clues every week, and we've alluded to this. It's the Helix, what is it?
Access Granted.
Helix Access Granted. What's this music?
Just giving you some energy.
All right. One clue was an auction receipt for a watch purchased by Sutton, but it was bought 100 years ago. So I don't think they age. I also think that Julia is Hitaki's natural child with a human woman. That's why she grows and ages. She also didn't need to escape because I don't think the others knew about her existence, so he let her go so she would be safe with them. I think that the injection turned her silver because it turned on Hitaki's latent genes. Keep up the good work. Few of these things were ratified. That's not the word I want. But like this episode proved a few of these points.
Yep.
I like this prediction. Eyes.
Yes. Valkyrie averse paladin of prose from Lilith Colbert. I love the way the hosts interact with the cast. It's like an old home week, not pretentious or stuffy at all. Keep up the great work. And Helix season 2 must happen.
Season 2.
Agreed. So thank you for that. Please keep those coming. It really does mean a lot, and it makes a difference for us here on the show. It makes our jobs easier to do. Okay, so we're trying to get into level X, this hidden level of the base that, you know, Hitaki hadn't told Alan and the crew about. and it's where they keep the master vault of all the diseases that they use to build this virus.
I love Alan's reaction to, like, when Itaki, like, reveals that there's something he has to tell me what? He's so mad. And that's basically his whole character summed up in three words.
Yeah.
Tell me what?
And also, Alan, please sleep with me again. We will get into that later. That line, I laughed for a solid 3 minutes.
I had to pause it.
I replayed it a few times. So funny, but we'll get to that. So, Level X, he and Julia have this. He has this plan. We're gonna freeze the whole base by letting all the cold air in, shutting off the power, and it goes down to -50, crazy cold. Risking hypothermia for everyone involved in this base. In order to do it, they get down to Level X and they find this vault filled with potentially every virus ever in history, from every outbreak ever. You know, Spanish flu, the Black Plague. It's crazy.
Yeah, that's, and those are not strange. Like, yeah, you hear about like one case a year if somebody randomly got bubonic plague, but that's, again, that's a crazy amount of things to have in one room.
And this is why I also think that you can tell that they've been around for so long, because they have things that have been like hundreds of years old.
Yeah.
Yeah, that you can't just find at your local
five and dime. Right.
And another theory I had on that was that these are previous viruses that they have created to release and thin out the population.
Oh, wow. Well, yeah. But no, because they couldn't have possibly had the technology to do that, you know, in the year 1000.
How do you know?
I don't. I frankly don't, so I can't
shut
that down.
I like that theory, because if you think about, like, let's say the Black Plague, it was spread through animals, much of the way it was spread, the vectors are spreading the virus now.
Right.
It was targeted to low, like, poor areas and everything, just to, like, it was, you could see it could have been population control. They could have whatever the level of science they had at the time, thinking that they could cure it. They eventually were able to take care of it to a certain extent.
Yeah.
So,
well, did that get cured or did it just die out?
We need a history buff.
Okay.
And we also know that Level X is an old, was it Russian?
Yeah, it was an old Russian
bunker.
Bunker, yeah.
Okay, well, we don't know how old that is, and we don't know who was in charge of that and what its use for was.
Well,
it could have been the same. It could have been
the original
Arctic biosystems.
I imagine that it was. I imagine that they've had this outpost for a very long time. Under the guise of different things, and it just evolved as society evolved.
It kind of looked like it was probably like Soviet Union era.
Yeah.
You know, Soviet Union.
So they're going there to destroy all the core samples of NARVIK A, NARVIK B. They're missing, ultimately stolen by Dr. Victor Adrian, who invented the cold suit.
Dick!
Drinking his vodka. We don't know what his agenda is. But he leaves the base with these samples. Mm-hmm. We'll predict what he wants them for at the end of the show. We gotta keep moving.
And where he's going.
Yeah. Like, where are you gonna go, bro? Where are you gonna go?
My question is, how did he get the samples?
Yeah.
Because if he went down there when it was...
When there was full of vectors, does that mean that he's a Silver Eyes?
That's the question.
Yeah.
Did he go down there beforehand? Has he been plotting this?
Maybe. It could. Yeah, no, these samples could have been missing since even before the CDC got there, if you think about it, because no one's been down to Level X, you know, this entire time. It's only been 9 days. So while they're down there, Julia and Alan have this standoff with Peter and his vector crew, and, you know, they won't harm Alan as long as Julia's in front of him. They're afraid of her. They're angry. They want to get at him. They're pissed that she's protecting him. But the other thing that they discover in their escape is the cabin from quote-unquote Montana that Julia saw in all of her dreams and all of her visions is actually part of the base. It's technically Level Z.
Yeah.
Is her like childhood summer home. What is that about?
I don't know, but Steve and I were discussing earlier, and we here at AfterBuzz called it.
Yeah,
kinda called it.
We did. Yep. We, you know, it's not real, and that she's, you know, she is Hitaki's daughter. Assuming that it's with this human scientist Jane, who was Jay, her vision.
Mm-hmm.
Great reveal there.
Although my only thing with that reveal, why was the picture torn?
Plot device. Or maybe it was too painful to look at Jane, or maybe he and Jane had a falling out And that's why Julia wasn't at the base anymore.
Yeah. Well, that's why I'm curious, because it was either too convenient that it just happened to get torn.
Yeah.
Or there's something else there.
Guys, because he didn't want her to know that he was her father just yet. He tore the picture and gave her the picture torn just so he could establish trust.
Okay.
Yeah. And also, we don't know how she died, Jane. So if he played a role in it, it obviously, you know, hurt him very badly. He didn't want to have to look at her.
I mean, what Steve said, that's a perfect theory, because the Silvers are heightened. We're assuming that they've heightened most of their abilities. Sure. Intelligence being one of them. Sure. That's a totally reasonable thing to think through.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
We know that he has burns on his back, and we know Jay said that was a lie, saving his daughter from fires. So you don't know how he got those flames or those burns.
It's true, and it definitely wasn't the Montana cabin that burned down. And he's obviously been here for a very long time. So we're not entirely sure where those burns came from. I'm liking more and more the fusion theory. It hasn't come up in a while, but maybe that's just so that it's a bigger gut punch when we find out about it in the episodes to come. 4 episodes left in the season. Julia, not ready to handle that he's her father. And, you know, great work from the whole cast. But Hiroyuki Sanada, I thought, did a great job this week.
Yeah.
In his scene with her and his work with Sarah.
His delivery of his Darth Vader line.
Yeah. And we were all ready for him to say, "I am your father." And I'm like, "Oh, yeah." And he's going to turn in 3, 2, "You have your father's eyes." And I was like, "Yeah, get it, Helix."
Search our feelings. You know it to be true.
Exactly.
It's basically what Julie does. She backs away. No.
Yeah.
No.
That's not true. That's impossible. Podcast. It's a free podcast. Okay. So on the other side of the Hatake coin, we have him with Sarah. They're playing a crucial role in this plot to get down to level X. They have to shut down the power by flipping a series of switches in sequence. And Sarah has her tremor returns, and she has a full-on seizure and like just a mental breakdown. From her cancer. We find out that the scar on her back was indeed a surgery scar, and that it wasn't able to get the tumor out
because it was too close to the spinal cord.
Yeah, and you know, great work from her this week, from Jordan Hayes. I loved this scene. She collapses, and then she's on the operating table in the ICU, and she starts talking in her sleep as Julia and Alan try to prep her. And then she says, "Alan, please sleep with me again." And I lost it, because no one says it like that. No, even when you're like passed out and you're like just muttering stuff to yourself, "Please sleep with me again."
She's in a seizure-induced hallucination, Matt.
But no one has that sequence of words in their brain. It just made me laugh in a way that it shouldn't have.
It reminded me of like, "Please respond."
Yeah.
Like a sad thing.
Yeah, it's like so pathetic, and I don't want her to be pathetic. I love, you know, that she's like, you know, I'm gonna die and it's not gonna have mattered at all. Like, I won't have left
that
anything
was
behind.
Insane. And that was a great performance, great writing.
Wonderful
in that
performance
scene.
Wonderful writing.
That was foreshadowing.
Well, what it does to me is it makes this one line all the more like pop out at me and just make me laugh uncontrollably.
I mean, it was hysterical, and I think it was supposed to be. Okay. I don't think it was anything like unrealistic.
Right.
Because, look, this is not something at the forefront of her mind. This is her subconscious talking. And yes, you do think that phrase. You think that phrase when you, but you would never say it that way.
Yeah.
You'd find some seductive, cool way to say it.
And I think you're right, because it also, this show, it has these, you know, these relationship squabbles and these triangles, but I think it looks at them in the same way that sci-fi fans look at them, where it's like, you know, we're going to be as honest and real with these as we possibly can, but you know and we know that we need to further complicate it and make things uncomfortable. So it just amplified the humor in Julia taking in this news and Alan trying to cover.
It did make me think, though, that we might see Julia and Alan with their relationship kind of develop a little bit more as we go forward because of her reaction. Like,
maybe
she's like, "No, we're divorced. It's totally cool. But you could tell it was not cool.
Actually, we can step away from them doing it a little bit. I want to talk about how she said, what she says in her delirium. She talks about how she's never going to cure the incurable. Her name's never going to go down in history.
Mm-hmm.
I feel that there's like some major, major foreshadowing here. And you know what I'm feeling with this character now is I feel like she's going to be the one to solve it. She's going to be the one that figures out the cure, but the cure is not what she thinks it is.
Mm.
And when she finds out what it really is, she's going to realize that as she cured the incurable, nobody can ever know, and her name will not be remembered for it.
I love this idea. It really does have a wonderful poetry to it in her arc. You know, I also think potentially if we're bringing Sodra into this, Sodra cures cancer. You know,
does
I don't.
It?
Yeah, yeah. So that was
four shot.
That was the reason why it was being developed was as a cure for cancer, Sodra.
But it doesn't. Was it effective in that way? It kills viruses.
It kills viruses, but it also killed cancer cells. The problem is, it also killed the patients who took it.
Yeah.
But their cancer cells were 100% wiped out. That was brought up, I think, 4 or 5 episodes ago to Alan when he was exploring it as a potential treatment for Peter.
Whoa!
So you
that
know,
just came to mind.
Bring it.
What cancer cells do? They reproduce uncontrollably.
Much like the silver eyes and all of their cells.
Much like the silver eyes and all their cells. And what does what is Sodra made for?
Oh!
What if Sodra was Hitaki's weapon against the other silver eyes?
I love this idea. Yeah. No, it's his retrovirus.
It's his fallback plan.
Exactly. You know, it's if you try to release the real virus, if you try to release NARVIK A, I will release Sodra into the air somehow, and I will wipe us all out.
That would be
mutually assured destruction.
Yeah, although that destroys everybody.
Sure.
If you think about it.
But then I want you to also think about this and go back to my theory in that everyone, humanity comes from these beings, so of course they're going to have some essence of cancer in them, because what cancer is an essence of the silver eyes. It's just, it's part of their genes that's been passed down. It's just evolved from keeping them immortal to being this terrible thing that kills them.
Here's what I love about this. It's like, if this theory proves to be true, this is one of the smartest shows I've ever come across. To figure that out and devise a mythology this intense and, you know, potentially scientifically feasible. I love this idea.
It hits a lot very close to home, especially today with all the cancer stuff going on in like the media and everything right now. A being made of pure cancer.
Yeah.
That's frightening.
That's very frightening, especially one that looks like us and is honestly better than us at just about everything.
But and then look at what happens when they incubated it.
Yeah.
Cancer grows uncontrollably, but it grows at a rate that's equal to a human's rate. Like a human cell regeneration rate,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
But if you take these cells, which we're assuming if this is like, if NARVIK is a sample of cells from an original, then it would multiply at their rate. And that's why when they incubate it, it multiplies at the rate at which it would have back then.
Let me ask a question that may spark off some thoughts. What would happen to a silver eyes if it was infected with NARVIK B?
I don't think it can be.
I mean, that's potentially possible, but I'm wondering.
Yeah, I mean, we see that, like, Julia's cured
of
the virus with becoming a silver. I think it's designed so that it wouldn't work. Like, the whole premise of it is designed so that it doesn't affect the silvers.
Okay. All right. We have about 15, maybe 20 minutes left. So we got to move on. We got to talk about Sergio and his escape and totally killing Klein, which I thought he was dead last week, but I'm glad he's dead now. Klein lets him know that Alaria sent a kill squad down to the village where Anana and Tuluk are, and, you know, he has to escape. And I'm like, goodbye, Sergio. You know, he's got a hero streak, and he loves that Anana.
He killed Awkward Window Bearded Man.
Yeah, Klein. Yeah. That's his name.
You know, he's Awkward Window Bearded Man.
Fine. Awkward Window Bearded Man, which I loved. You guys saw Steve Maeda, who's on the show.
Yeah. Loved it.
Yeah.
One of the writers.
His favorite new location.
I love it. I'm so glad. that he approves. So Sergio, rushing off to save her, Mixa charges at him, totally decks him, thinking that, you know, he's just trying to escape, realizes what's going on, and they team up, zooming across the landscape in the middle of the night, trying to save the village.
On their land speeders.
On their land speeders, because this is, again, this is The Empire Strikes Back, but not really. So Inanna finds them after they can't find the trail anymore, and they all head down to the village just in time to see the whole village being herded into this building where they're going to set it on fire so that there's less to clean up. Terrifying. And they're able to take out the Ilaria guys. But
yeah,
first,
that was dark.
I know. But I loved how they tricked the Ilaria guys. Sergio comes down there with Mixa, you know, and Inanna. He's like, he's bringing Inanna in as if she's another hostage to be burned, and that Mixa's working with him. Taluk and Mixa look at each other for the first time, and he totally decks Taluk, and he calls him an Eskimo, which is a big no-no in the Inuit community.
Mm-hmm. Nerf herder.
Yeah, you don't do that. I can't wait to talk to Miguin about acting opposite himself.
Yeah.
And punching himself a few
times.
In
the face.
Yeah. Wonder if he got to punch a stunt guy. That's pretty great.
Yeah.
I mean, I figure...
He's getting punched by the stunt guy both
times. That's true.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I'm going to throw another Star Wars thing in there.
Do it.
So let's just say Sergio is the Han Solo to Miguin's Chewbacca, and Sergio shot first.
Oh, we think we are funnier than we are. But I like us. I love seeing this family.
I'm Luke Skywalker, Matt.
I love seeing this family back together, guys. I love seeing Mixa kind of like summoning his old memories.
Wait, so in this theory, is Sarah Leia or is Julia Leia? Because either way, Alan, no.
Yeah, let's not go deeper down this rabbit hole. I'm shutting it down. I love seeing this family back together. You know, all of these years and years of separation and pain are undone. You know, it's going to be a slow build, but I'm glad that they're together. And now we have sort of our two separate units. We have our inside the base team, and we have our away team.
Although, here's my thing with the whole scene with, like, where they've got Taluk down and everything. It's like, you have the two guys that are clearly twins. Doesn't that raise some red flags for the Ilaria guys?
Right. He's like, that guy's one of the villagers, instead of being like, that guy looks just like our hostage. Wait a second. Like, wait a minute. I thought that's the guy we got right here. But you're also over there.
And they keep the one hostage outside the trailer.
Right.
They know Daniel from the base. They had seen Daniel before.
No, but I thought we kill all the Ilaria guys?
No, these are different.
The same guys.
Same guys.
Okay.
Not all the Ilaria guys are dead. These were ones that got out of the base before they were able to take it back.
Okay.
But Daniel was part of the first crew that they met when they entered the base, so would recognize him.
Withdrawn.
Yeah. But still interesting. Glad they're together. Interested to see where that goes. We're waiting on this Ilaria army to come down that are going to be way worse than Sutton.
I imagine they're going to send some silvers in now.
Mm-hmm.
Hashtag Ilarmia.
Ilarmia? You mean Ilaria?
The Ilaria army.
Ilarmia. Ugh. Damn you. So now we've also got Dr. Victor Adrian, who's got these NARVIK samples. Where's he going?
It was one of two things. Either there's some kind of transport out there that nobody else knows about.
Right.
Because he's working for some outside party that we have not been introduced to yet.
Yeah.
Some like underground revolutionary. If we go back to that.
Maybe it's another like a splinter group of silvers.
Or maybe whatever's what I was saying before, like whatever's behind the vectors, whatever like the past of that is.
Hmm.
If it's something, it's a bit of, that one's a bit of a stretch.
Right.
But
that's making me think of like a war in the Middle Ages between vectors and silvers on like the fields of Scotland or something.
The only reason that leads me to think that is just the like seeing Peter as like a leader of the vector, and they bow down to him. This isn't like they are helping him out and like
so
he's
cool.
control or he's like controlling them.
Yeah.
It was a great scene. I loved when he hops up there and he just yells, but then they bow. Like that was a power move. They saw him as a god above them.
Mm-hmm.
that leads me to believe that whatever the hive mind consciousness is, there's something old in there.
Yeah.
That NARVIK is like the last remaining, almost like a venom type thing.
Yeah, and they didn't even get to look at all of the viruses that were in that vault. They didn't get to destroy all of them. So there could be something in there that they've never even heard of that could be the root of NARVIK from long ago.
Honestly, though, it was kind of comical that there was just like a bumper sticker. Burner. Oh, that's convenient.
Incinerator, yeah.
I mean, I guess maybe you keep that. I mean, we don't know the layout of labs, but I guess when you have stuff that's that dangerous that you can't transport,
right.
Maybe I mean, it makes sense to have something like that nearby.
I have one of those in my baby's nursery. Nothing bad will happen. I mean, come on. Like, it was kind of too convenient.
Fine.
A little bit. It was.
Fine.
I'm trying to give
it's just proper
credit.
Protocol. Honestly, I think the reason why you have an incinerator in your virus vault is just in case you do get caught by some kind of government, you get rid of the evidence the only way that you can.
Touche.
Yeah. All right. Yeah.
Okay. I feel like we've covered a lot of this episode stuff. Are we singing? Are we doing that?
We have time.
All right. We got time.
I just want to... I'm just looking through in my mind to make sure we did cover everything.
What do you think, Zach? I feel like we're pretty thorough.
Yeah. I mean... the one thing that... line that I want to talk about, because they brought it back up.
Yeah.
It's about you, Julia. It's always been about you. That, like, so... That I love the demigod theory.
Yeah.
But so what is it about Julia that really is so important?
Maybe she's the first. Maybe she's the first half human, half silver to exist or that's lived.
I think the first question is who is Jane?
Yeah.
Because we got to figure out where she fits in all of this because Hitaki wouldn't have just gone after someone normal. So I really think that Jane plays more of a role in this than we think.
I mean, it could be as simple if he is a god mm-hmm. of sorts. Like, gods fall in love, especially in Greek myths, fall in love with humans all the time. It's a regular... He talks about her in this episode, how much he loved her scientific ability, how much she loved the science she was doing. She was a fantastic person and a fantastic scientist, and that hit all the notes for him, and he just fell in love. I would buy that as this very simple explanation.
Yeah. I'm willing to go down that road. We have some time left in this season to get some of those answers. Mm-hmm.
I also think that the virus itself was created as a way to transfer DNA material to bond with DNA.
Mm-hmm.
So if you imagine in vitro fertilization mixed with the virus to put Hitaki's DNA into fertilize an egg and do like a test tube baby, maybe Julia is a test tube baby utilizing the virus to transfer Hitaki's DNA to the human DNA.
Maybe. It's entirely possible. Very, very curious about that.
I feel intelligent talking about this, but I have no idea.
You are intelligent. And also, you know, now that the virus, thanks to Dr. Adrian, is now outside of the base, that kind of opens up some questions about what we're going to see in season two. Now that it's no longer contained to the Arctic, you know, we've had some cast members on the show intimating that there will still be some sort of containment. We will still be trapped in a location, but not necessarily this one.
Well, we see, I mean, I think we talked about it a little bit in the pilot, right in the beginning of the show,
mm-hmm.
there's a guy leaving the base on the chopper that they come in on.
That's true.
Yeah, we talked about that.
Yeah, we talked about it a little bit, and that's like, you don't even need Dr. Adrian to get away.
Mm-hmm.
There's your virus outbreak right there. We've been out of touch except for Ilaria, and they're keeping everything quiet. They don't have to tell us at the base anything.
Yeah.
Who knows what's going on?
Because they're not asking for the virus. They're asking for the cure.
Yeah. Something wrong with the sound? Are we all right?
Somebody opened the booth door.
Okay. Anyway, do we have the song? We this episode closed with Mad World, which, you know, some people, especially Donnie Darko fans, big fans of Mad World. To me, I always thought Mad World was a little goofy.
Super
but it
cliche,
fit,
and
it
all fit, I can think of is the Gears of War commercial.
It fit the episode. do we have it? We're going to do a little parody action? Yeah.
Is this the right version?
Yeah.
Sounds right.
All around me are a million vectors, always zizzing, cups they're filling, Julia has eyes, they're made of silver. They are her father's. What happened to her mother? And Sarah wants Alan to sleep with her again. She's really...
You're at the wrong
point. Am I wrong?
Yeah.
Oh, that's a bummer.
Hide my head, I wanna drown my vectors. They are zizzing. They are zizzing. And I... that's where you're going.
To have her
to be sad.
Oh, yeah. We didn't write lyrics.
Sarah is dying of some cancer
that
in her head.
That's true. And Victor, he is gone with NARVIK A. NARVIK B is another virus that we'll see another day.
You guys suck so bad.
Oh, we're the best. Stop it. Okay.
Think of a better song.
Okay. We've said it before. Prep. Preparation.
I don't care. All right, predictions.
All right, let me bring the soundboard up. And
okay.
Prediction.
AFTERBUZZ TV predictions.
Okay. Yeah. So we've been theorizing all episode long.
Nothing but predictions, really.
But what do we think is happening next week? Now, I get my episodes through Xbox Video. I didn't see the preview for next week.
We got a little shot of Sarah in a CAT scan.
Okay.
Somebody's saying she doesn't have much time.
Sure.
Which, yeah, she definitely doesn't. Alan said if NARVIK makes it out of the Arctic Circle, millions will die. So they know it's gone.
Yeah.
They're assuming it's off the base. So I imagine they're going to be scouring the area.
For Dr. Adrian.
Yeah. And we got a little bit on this week's Access Granted on the online stuff. There was a picture of Hitaki and this mystery guy we've never met before. Mm-hmm. This skinny dude. Somewhere.
Maybe Dr. Havit?
No, much younger.
Okay.
I mean, who knows how old, but the picture is a digital photo.
Okay.
But they're clearly not at the base. There's like green behind them. Mm-hmm. So they're at some kind of normal location.
Okay.
And a soundbite of somebody saying, free me, over and over and over again. Free me, free me.
And they played this. They played this for me, and it's really awesome. And you should totally go and check that out.
It's creepy. I don't think it's any of our characters, our main characters.
It's not Peter.
Yeah.
Free me.
Yeah.
Free me.
I don't know. It could be the thoughts of one of these frozen heads, maybe. And maybe that's just like grasping at straws.
You hear chains clinking. So oh yeah, somebody tied up.
Yeah.
Fascinating. Well, we're probably going to find out more next week. I'm hoping next week is a Hitaki flashback episode because it feels like now that we've gotten some big reveals, it's about time.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
I want to see more of, and I hope we see more, Peter and the Vector society that is evolving down there. Because it's not just a bunch of random zombies in a basement. They are plotting.
Yeah.
There's a plot abrew.
I'm going to throw this out there, and I know that it's wild. What if it's the voice of the virus? Like, if it is something ancient and, you know, like, is like a consciousness. I don't know.
The free me?
Yeah. All right, I felt it was thin myself. What do you think, Steven?
This whole show's been my predictions.
All right, fair enough.
Yeah, I think we have like 3 more minutes if we want to do something else. It's up to you guys. Any otherwise people can just tune out right now unless you guys don't want to.
I think we got it pretty much covered.
All right. Cool. All right.
So,
let me roll this.
Yeah, roll the thing. So, here's the thing, folks. Liz Rishmawi couldn't be here today, but you know, you can follow her on Twitter. She's quite delightful. You can follow her at Lizzie Maui, LizzyMawy. And give her some well wishes. She's feeling under the weather.
Get better soon, Liz.
Yeah. Zach, where can the people find you?
You can find me on Twitter and Instagram at ThatZachWilson. That's ThatZachWilson. And here at AfterBuzz on Grim Archer, Almost Human finale coming up tomorrow.
Yep.
And starting next week, Resurrection on ABC, which I'll be doing with Matt Lieberman
here. Yes, it's very exciting. Steven Lemieux.
You can find me here at AfterBuzz TV doing the Twisted After Show, as well as coming up Oh man, coming up a lot of stuff.
We got Orphan Black in April.
Yeah, Orphan Black in April. And what's that other show I do? I can't even remember right now.
We'll figure it out. You'll tweet it out, folks.
Also, you can find me on Twitter at Stephen Lemieux, StephenLemieux.
That's correct.
And then me going in the next few weeks.
Yes, and we'll be announcing that on our Twitters. So follow us so that you can find out exactly when that's going to be, and you can tweet us your questions for him. It's going to be really exciting. You can follow me on Twitter at Matt Lieberman. That's MattLieberman here on AfterBuzz TV, all over the place. Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., Almost Human, ending tomorrow. Cougar Town, Justified, Banshee on Cinemax, Lost Girl. I have Resurrection coming up with Zach Wilson. Mm-hmm. I got Playing House, the new USA comedy coming out in April. We got Orphan Black in April. We have Mad Men coming back this spring. Anyway, love you all. See you next week. Goodbye.
From executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Ziz you later!
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.
Thank you for watching AfterBuzz TV on YouTube. For more of your favorite after shows and interviews, subscribe to our channel here and be sure to share your opinion on the episode in the comment section below here. We'd love to see what you guys are buzzing about. Thanks again. Buzz you later.